Thanks all for being here. This is a stunning turnout for 8:30 in the morning on a university campus. So it's a great testament to how important this topic is, and also how lucky we are to have Dr. Pachauri here, as well as Ted and Michael. I'm going to let Carlos Pascual, a senior fellow at the Center on Global Energy Policy, lead this, but just by way of welcome, I wanted to say my name is Jason Bordoff. I'm a member of the faculty here at Columbia School of International Public Affairs, founding director of the Center on Global Energy Policy, and I'm really thrilled by the conversation that we're going to have this morning. There's been a lot of conversation this week about what needs to be done in the global climate space, and 300,000 people showing up in New York just a few days ago to remind the world of what needs to be done. And not always is there as much discussion as there should be about the sort of hard-headed reality of the capital investment that will be required to see that change happen, particularly in emerging parts of Asia, where the growth rates for coal right now are troubling and really quite staggering. So that's what we're going to talk about today, what the barriers are, what the drivers are of the capital investment needed to see the sort of transformation that we need to see in the energy sector, and what sorts of policy role for government is necessary to facilitate that. And so I'm really delighted that Carlos really came up with the idea to do this and put this event together. We're thrilled at the center that Carlos has joined us a few weeks ago. As many of you know, Ambassador Pascual, until about a month or two ago, led the Energy Bureau at the U.S. State Department, which he founded. Before that, he was the ambassador to Mexico. Before that, the ambassador to the Ukraine, senior director at the National Security Council. Before that, for Russia, Ukraine, and Eurasia, all very relevant topics in the energy world right now, and then spent many years at Brookings in between stints in government service. So we're really honored that he, when he left government, decided to join us here at Columbia at the Center on Global Energy Policy. And so let me turn it over to Carlos, please.
Jason, thank you very much. What I'm hoping is that by being here together in this discussion, that we're adding to a revolutionary process. And in that revolutionary process, we need to have people who are ready to march on a topic which is not always terribly sexy and focused on, but it's a fundamental question of what drives investment in energy and what the nature of that investment is going to be. Because if we don't understand that issue, and if we can't change the trends of investment, then everything that we're seeking to do on climate change will fail. Because in the end, markets will take us somewhere else. And so one of the unique things that New York has to offer, that Columbia University has to offer, the reason that when I left the government, I wanted to come here, is that there are really few other places in the world that operate at this intersection of energy, investment, finance, and have the ability to integrate that with the implications for climate. And so that's really what this event is about today. We're really fortunate to have in leading us in this discussion somebody who is a leader in this world, Dr. R.K. Pachauri. Patchy, as he's known around the world to, I was going to say thousands of people, actually millions of people. People don't even know Patchy, call him Patchy, because he is an individual of such humanity and humility, and at the same time of such talent. He's the CEO of the Energy and Resources Institute, which is based in India. Many people know him as the chairman of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. I got to know him in both capacities, and in both capacities, he has just won my respect and admiration. When you think about what the IPCC has done, it's that it has brought together the views and the analyses of scientists, of thousands of scientists around the world, and has been able to get a convergence on the scientific foundation for the arguments of what causes climate change, the path that it is taking, the pace that it is going on, and the kinds of steps that we're going to have to do to address it. And he's stimulated a debate around the world about what the implications are if we don't fix this problem. And to be able to do that in a way that has the credibility and the scientific foundations of the most talented individuals around the world is a testimony to his capacity, first as an intellect, an academic, and a scholar, but secondly as an individual of great humanity. So you go to Dr. Pachauri's office and you look around and you start seeing all of the tournament, all of the trophies from his masterful performance as a cricket player. And not everybody knows that he is such a tremendous cricket player, but if you go into his office, you quickly sort of recognize that because the trophies are everywhere. And you start looking around, and all of a sudden, in the middle of the cricket trophies, there's this one other trophy, which is quite compelling, which is a Nobel Prize. And it is indicative of the individual and the talent that he brings. So today what we would like to do is to begin this discussion with a presentation of Dr. Pachauri on the challenges that are before us, and then to go into a discussion with two other individuals who are making a name here in New York, but globally. Ted Roosevelt, who's a managing director for investment banking, responsible for a committee on sustainability at Barclays, and one of the leading voices of how to direct and influence those trends of investment and incentives for investment in New York, but from New York, and because of the importance of Barclay and his personal stature, how that can have an impact globally. And Michael Eckhart, managing director at Citigroup, responsible for environment and sustainability. One of the things that Michael has done and taught me a great deal about is the foundation for green bonds and what they mean, and he has been one of the leading movers of being able to stimulate the promotion of green bonds, again, starting in the United States, but now moving globally. And so what we hope to do is have a discussion that gets us into the depths of these issues of the intersection between energy, climate, finance, and investment. And I hope you join this revolutionary movement to make a difference and have an impact. So with that, let me ask Dr. Pachauri to please lead us in this discussion. And Pachi, thanks very much for doing this.
Thank you very much, Carlos. That I certainly didn't deserve that very generous introduction. And that's only an indication of his warmth and friendship. Carlos is a wonderful person. He's a great scholar himself. And as all of you know, his insights on policy issues related to energy, climate change, and environmental subjects is really something of outstanding value. I feel very honored with the distinguished company that I'm in. And it's, of course, a great privilege to be here in Columbia University. I think the subject that...
Put on your slides.
Sure.
There you go.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I think the subject that Ambassador Pascual has described to you and put forward as the subject for our discussion today is something of crucial importance. I think if we have to bring about a transition, as indeed we must, we necessarily have to go through a process that essentially stimulates investment in the new scenario of energy that clearly the world is now going to focus on. And that, to my mind, is a daunting challenge, because unless one gets the policy framework right, and unless one understands how the whole process is going to work, clearly we may be left with wishful thinking and be stuck with business as usual. And I spoke at the opening session of the Secretary General's Summit yesterday And it was nice to see that everyone essentially emphasized the fact that business as usual is not an option. And there were, of course, illustrious personalities like Leonardo DiCaprio. And last night I spoke at dinner where I said I've learned two lessons in life. And one of them, of course, is the fact that you shouldn't share the stage with icons and celebrities. Some years ago in 2008, I received an honorary doctorate from Yale. And in the commencement procession that was taking place, who else was there receiving an honorary doctorate but Sir Paul McCartney? And nobody noticed me at all, but everybody was, "Sir Paul, Sir Paul." You know, everyone was going crazy. And yesterday in the opening session, several of us spoke, but the one who stood out, of course, was Leonardo DiCaprio. So next time I'm going to avoid those situations. I'm basically going to raise a few issues before you, and then I have a very brief PowerPoint presentation, but I wouldn't want you to focus on that solely. I think the main problem at this point of time is, as far as I can see, related primarily to what's going to happen in Asia. Of course, Africa, Latin America will follow, but Asia is where there's a large quantity of consumption of coal. That's one region where you see economic growth reaching unprecedented levels. So the challenge is really a very complex one. How do you bring about change without in any way affecting economic growth in the downward direction? And I can put forward the case of India. We, of course, consume less coal than the United States. This is something that's not very well known. The U.S. is still a major consumer of coal. But it's also true that for India to deal not merely with the global problem of climate change, but also several objectives that are an inherent part of national development, we would have to move away from coal. Why? Well, firstly, there are about 300 million people in India who have no access to electricity. And a large number, possibly just as many, of those who do get electricity, but it's so erratic, it's so unreliable, that it certainly does not enhance their quality of life. So what are the choices that you have for this large section of society? I think as long as you rely on centralized power generation, for which coal is clearly the dominant fuel, you would not really be able to serve this very large section of society. And with prices and costs having come down to where they are today, clearly there's a major benefit in moving towards renewable sources of energy which can be exploited and harnessed on a decentralized and distributed basis. But when you look at the economics of it, there is a gray area simply because we don't add the cost of the negative externalities that, for instance, coal is imposing to the price of power that's generated. And as far as renewables are concerned, there is still a perception that, unfortunately, the price of renewables is very, very high. And often, in decisions of this nature, perceptions are much more important than reality. So how do you bring about that shift? One way to do it is by demonstrating that this is really a viable option. And I would normally have shown you a brief film, but I won't do that. I just want to tell you that my institute launched a major program called Lighting a Billion Lives, whereby we're essentially taking solar energy to the homes of the rural poor to ensure that they get clean, durable, and reliable lighting in their homes. And I'll just mention to you how this works. Typically, we train a woman in a village to charge a set of solar lanterns which we have developed. These are light, LED-based solar lanterns. They also have a little outlet from which you can charge your cell phone, because as it happens, everybody in India now has a cell phone, the poorest of the poor. And for them to charge these cell phones is quite a challenge, because you don't have electricity in the villages. Therefore, someone or the other has to get a battery or a set of batteries, and he starts a little business where everybody in the village comes and charges that telephone. So if you have a lantern which picks up solar energy, you can also charge your cell phone, then that's a multiple function and utility, which of course adds to the benefit of this technology. So just to complete the story, we train a woman in a village to charge all the solar lanterns during the daytime, and she rents them out at night and gets them back in the morning. So it's essentially a market-based model. But how do you jumpstart this whole business? Someone has to get the funds by which you invest in the solar lanterns. You also invest in the solar panel on the roof by which this woman can charge all the lanterns during the daytime. And what we did was to essentially get grant money from a variety of sources. And we've covered about 3,000 villages in India and in Africa. Now, the benefit of this kind of demonstration was that the private sector realized that here is an opportunity. And now a number of people are emulating this model purely as a business enterprise. So I only wanted to mention this briefly as an example of one possibility by which you can create a business opportunity. But again, you would need some kind of funding to get it going. However, let me quickly go through this presentation that I was going to make. And this is a quote that I use very often. It was Einstein who said, problems cannot be solved at the level of awareness that created them. And the reality is that we basically now have a lot more knowledge. We certainly have a great deal of knowledge on the subject of climate change and the science of climate change. And therefore, this knowledge should be utilized effectively to see that we find a solution to a problem which apparently was created because we probably didn't know the consequences of these emissions of greenhouse gases, which have increased substantially in the atmosphere. And if you look at the findings of the fifth assessment report of the IPCC, we're going to be completing that cycle by the end of October when we bring out the synthesis report, but three working group reports have already been completed. We can now say that there's a 95% certainty that human influence has been the dominant cause of changes in the climate that have taken place since the middle of the 20th century. This, may I say, is up from a level of 90% that we had stated in the fourth assessment report, which came out in 2007. And of course, we've also said that since the 1950s, the changes that have taken place have been unprecedented over decades to millennia. So in other words, in this very short period of time, the world has made changes that have not occurred for thousands of years. And we also know that limiting climate change will require sustained and substantial reductions in greenhouse gas emissions. So this can only happen if we bring about a major shift in the mix of energy that we're going to use in the future. These are some of the sources of emissions, electricity and heat production, that's about 25%. AFOLU stands for agriculture, forestry, and land use. The transport sector contributes about 14%, industry 21%. But these are direct emissions. On the right-hand side, you see indirect emissions. And these are essentially because if, let's say, you were to take industry, there's a whole supply chain for industry which is also responsible for emissions. And therefore, you really need to add all these together to get a full measure of how much a particular sector is contributing to emissions. Now, this is something that gives you an indication of the global challenge that we face. Greenhouse gas emissions have grown in every region over the last 40 years. 330% in Asia, 70% in the Middle East and Africa, 57% in Latin America and the Caribbean, and 22% in the OECD, 4% in the economies in transition. So when I highlighted the challenge of Asia, you can see that from these numbers, because clearly this is where, you know, the battle for bringing down emissions of greenhouse gases will really be fought. Also, may I say that you cannot see Asia in isolation of, let's say, what happens in the OECD countries, because lifestyles, technologies, production and consumption patterns are so influenced by what you see in North America that you're not likely to be able to bring about a change unless you also see some change taking place in North America. Why? Because I think there's one institution in the world that has influenced modern living and the way people aspire to that form of living, and that institution is called Hollywood. You go to a slum in Mumbai, people will not have a single piece of furniture, but they will have a television set. And what are they watching? They're watching all the soap ops. So what drives their aspirations, as Tom Friedman rightly said, is the fact that they all want to be like Americans. And he said the problem with the world is that there are too many Americans. Everybody aspires to the same standard of living. Another comment he made a year ago when I saw him last, he says the trouble with India is that it's not just the middle class which has middle class aspirations. Today, the poor, the poorest of the poor, has also got similar aspirations. And actually, you see that in practice. You see the way they bring up their children, even the poorest of the poor. They make sure that those kids have aspirations similar to what, you know, upper classes in society and in the economic structure would have. So anyway, if you look at the differences in these two diagrams, on the left-hand side are aggregate emissions for different regions of the world. On the right-hand side, you see per capita values. And it's interesting that above the value for, let's say, the world, you have some regions which are much higher and some which are lower. In Asia, there's enormous disparity. And I might also say that you find that the richest of Asia really have consumption patterns which are no different from those that you have in the developed world. And the poorest are way down. I mean, there's enormous disparity, and the disparity, unfortunately, is growing. Now, if you look at the share of CO2 emissions from fossil fuels combustion in developing countries, here again, you often get the argument from China, for instance, don't hold us responsible for the aggregate emissions that you compute for China, because a large part of these emissions are because we are producing goods and services for you guys. And, you know, you can see this over here in the case of the diagram on the left, as well as the one on the right, you have per capita values over here. You have territorial, these are blue dotted lines versus consumption-based, which are red lines for emissions in five world regions. And this is for a 20-year period from 1990 to 2010. Now, the left panel presents total emissions, while the right panel presents per capita emissions. And the red areas indicate that the region is a net importer of embedded CO2 emissions, and the blue area indicates a region is a net exporter. So you can see the way this has been changing over a period of time. So when you're talking about changes in the structure of energy production and supply, then you also need to see how to bring this about. For instance, if China is going to be exporting a large number of goods and services where coal is the main source of energy that essentially drives that production, how do you bring about a shift? Should there be some kind of a tariff that, in a sense, makes those goods more expensive just because they are produced on the basis of consumption of coal? Or should there be something domestically in China that would bring about a clear reflection of the externalities that coal is producing? Now, what you see over here is the contribution of energy sources to global and regional primary energy use increments. And what is important over here is that modern biomass contributes 40% of the total biomass share. So that's growing. You know, in the past, a large part of the developing world used biomass for cooking purposes, using, you know, fuel wood, using animal waste, vegetable agricultural residues, and so on. But that share is changing. Now there's a greater share of modern biomass that's coming into being. I'm raising this issue only because if you look at a country like India, we have about 500 million tons, which is estimated as the total quantity of agricultural residue that's produced. A large part of it is just burnt. Some of it as a nuisance because you want to get rid of it. Other, maybe about 50% of that goes as cooking fuel in homes. Now, if there was a system by which you could produce modern fuels out of that mass of this residue, then clearly you would achieve certain efficiencies and environmental improvements that would benefit not just the local community, but globally also there would be benefits. Now, I think the impacts of climate change on the financial sector are quite serious. Finally, I think what we are dealing with is an assessment of risk in decisions that are taken. Climate change will affect all sectors of the economy, and risks have to be perceived by investors and financial institutions, which obviously include expected reduction in productivity and economic growth, direct physical impacts of climate change, which will affect assets and investments. Let's say we were to take a mitigation decision by which we move away from coal-based power generation, you would obviously have stranded assets left. And then there are knock-on effects, such as a threat to social stability posed by high and volatile food prices. We know that climate change has serious impacts on agriculture. In fact, in the fifth assessment report, we have much greater evidence of that than we had in the previous report, because there's been a lot of research on the impacts of climate change on agriculture. And there are three crops in particular which are very vulnerable to the impacts of climate change: wheat, maize, and paddy. And these, as you know, are the sort of staple crops for many parts of the world. And impacts of policies to reduce greenhouse gases from electricity generation, large industrial sources, transport, and other sectors. So all of this is part of the risk. Now, the point I'd like to make is what sometimes defies logic is the fact that if we were to bring about stringent mitigation, and we've assessed this in the fifth assessment report, and embarked on a pathway of emissions that would ensure that we don't increase temperature rise to beyond 2 degrees Celsius by the end of the century, then really speaking, the costs are very low. In other words, moving from, say, fossil fuel-based energy to a more renewable based system or higher levels of efficiency are really not costly at all. If you look at the median estimates over here, in 2030, it would be 1.7% of the total global consumption. In 2050, 3.4%. And of course, by the end of the century, 4.8%. Now, you would ask, with this kind of cost and the enormous benefits of doing away with some of the worst impacts of climate change, why is it that we're not making investments to move in this direction? And that, I hope, is something that we can discuss in the panel a little later. But there are obviously market imperfections over here which are resulting in this business of business as usual. And to be able to limit temperature increase to 2 degrees Celsius, what's really required is that in 2050 we would have to have lower global greenhouse gas emissions than in 2010. This would have to be 40 to 70% lower globally than what we had in 2010. And emissions levels would have to be near zero in gigatons of CO2 equivalent or below by the year 2100. Now, in order to bring this about, just using renewables may not be enough, because basically you'll have to suck out a lot of carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases from the atmosphere. And for that, you would need to stop deforestation. You would have to expand forest area in a big way. You would need carbon capture and storage technology. And what we have also provided as an option is bioenergy and carbon capture and storage. So, you know, you really have to develop a large number of these technologies, which certainly before the end of the century should be commercially viable. But that would happen only if we have policies, only if we have research and development that brings about such a shift in efforts. And by the middle of the century, we'll have to treble or quadruple the share of energy supply from renewables by 2050. So that's a very clear target. And of course, that'll only happen if we put in place policies today that will spur investment going into these areas. Otherwise, it's not going to happen. So that, again, is something that we need to discuss. If the world is to move in that direction and to ensure that renewable sources are mobilized to this level, how do we bring about investments to make it happen? And many scenarios have been assessed by us for reaching 450, 500, and 550 ppm CO2 equivalent by 2100. But these will require widespread deployment of BECCS, which means bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, afforestation, and other carbon dioxide reduction technologies post 2050. So post 2050, we'll have to have a large mix of new technologies. How do we make that happen? How do investments need to follow that kind of a goal as quickly as possible? Just a quick summary of things that I wanted to place before you for the discussion that's to take place. Annual investments in conventional fossil fuel technologies would decline by about $30 billion. So the median of this basically means that we'll have to move investment away from conventional fossil fuels to low carbon electricity supply, which is renewables, nuclear, electricity generation with CCS. And therefore, you're really talking about a major shift from fossil fuels to these technologies, including renewables. And the annual incremental energy efficiency investments in transport, buildings, and industry are also projected to increase by a substantial amount. You're talking about $336 billion. So if we are to meet the target of, say, no more than 2 degrees Celsius in temperature increase by the end of the century, you really would need to bring about a massive shift in investments. You can see the staggering scale of what is being talked about over here. How does one make that happen? That's a major question. And about $340 billion was invested in mitigating climate change in 2011-12, with 62% of this amount provided by the private sector. Let me emphasize that it's not easy to identify these as mitigation measures. This is just, in some sense, an approximation. And governments will look to the private sector to provide much of the capital. And private finance has a critical role to play. But willingness of private investors and financial institutions to provide this capital will depend on how they view the risks associated with policy and the incentives that are provided. So that's really the key. How do you provide a policy framework and incentives by which you can move investments from conventional energy supply to something that would take us towards lower emissions? This is the last point I wanted to make. We brought out a special report on renewable energy and climate change mitigation in 2011. And in this, we found that for several applications, renewable energy is already viable on an economic basis. And you see over here biomass electricity, solar electricity. The band on the left gives you the cost of conventional power, but the bars that you see over here give you the range of renewable energy costs. And there is clearly an area of overlap between the conventional versus the renewable sources that you have over here. So for certain applications, clearly renewables have come, they have arrived. And we therefore have to make sure that the market signals make things happen in such a way that these technologies can be utilized on a large scale. There are, of course, major co-benefits from mitigation measures which are not always captured by the market. Improved energy efficiency, improved energy security. You have cleaner energy sources, that means lower levels of pollution at the local level. Air quality will improve, human health will benefit. Reduced energy and water consumption in urban areas. Sustainable agriculture and forestry, and protection of ecosystems for carbon storage. A stable climate is also an important part of sustainable development, and limiting the effects of climate change is necessary to achieve sustainable development and equity, including poverty eradication. So designing an effective climate policy involves mainstreaming climate in the design of sustainable development policies. And the options for equitable burden sharing can reduce the potential for the costs of climate action to constrain development. And this is where we're really stuck. We really don't have a very clear agreement on burden sharing when it comes to bringing about change. So here I would like to mention two quotes. Margaret Mead said, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." I wonder if we have the nucleus in every sector, in every stakeholder group to bring about that change. And certainly in the financial sector, you would need that kind of a change. How do you bring about a shift? And this is true, of course, in business, industry, in government, but we just have to somehow get that nucleus of strength by which we can bring about change. And the trouble with our system of economic production and consumption today is that it relies purely on GDP. It really doesn't look at the externalities, both negative and positive. And therefore, if we measure GDP and say a country is growing at 10% per annum, I'm not too sure whether we can pat ourselves on the back. There are several countries where you find that this growth has been achieved with very large consequences of a negative nature for the environment. And if that's the case, are we really justified in feeling good about 10% or 9% rate of growth of the GDP? And if that's not the case, then I think Gandhi was right. Speed is irrelevant if you're going in the wrong direction. Okay. So I'll stop here, and I hope we can dwell on some of these issues in the panel discussion. Thanks, Carlos. Thank you very much.
Actually, please stay here. Let me just ask Patchy a couple of questions, and I'm going to invite Ted and then Mike. But why don't you stay here for 1 second? First of all, thank you for the presentation. And one of the things you always do when you talk is that you make these connections between issues that are global in nature and consequence, where national decisions matter, where private investment matters. But in the end, we also have to measure it up against the impact on individuals, their choices, their opportunities in life. And if you don't have that whole spectrum in mind, what you remind us is you can't come up with solutions that actually work. And thank you for having that spectrum in your perspective, the way you've perceived it and the way that you've worked on it in the IPCC. I wanted to ask you first, Patchy, if I could, for advice on politics. And I know that's not always the area that you immediately jump into, but you wouldn't have survived as the chairman of IPCC for so long if you didn't understand politics and handle it in a very clever way. You pointed out the challenge of Asia, and I agree with you completely on that. And I'm going to add a couple of figures because the staggering nature of it is striking to me. I mean, you look at China, where they consume 51% of the world's coal, and it's 68% of the fuel mix now. It's going to decline in the fuel mix, but the absolute volumes are going to increase. So it's like, on the one hand, we feel good that the percentages are going down, but it's the overall real scientific problem is getting worse. India, 44% of the fuel mix is coal, and it's increasing, 2 or 3% a year right now. Southeast Asia in power generation, the IEA has projected that coal is going to go from about 28% of the fuel mix to almost 50% of the fuel mix by 2035. Right? So it just gives you a sense of the scale of that issue that you raised and the dilemma that you face, where you come back and you said, well, geez, this is only 1.7% of GDP globally in cost, and we're going to save the planet, and why don't we do this? And at the same time, what we're seeing on the flip side is something very different in terms of investment patterns and trends, which in the end, we have to come back to that issue in Asia. But then you alluded to the historical legacy of these issues, where it's times have changed. It's not exactly the G77 of yesterday, but there still is this legacy of, from the developing and emerging economies to the developed world of, you guys caused this problem to begin with, and so why should we have to pay for it now? And so we face this very, very critical dialogue in Asia on how to change patterns of investments and trends and incentives. But there's a huge political sensitivity about it, both at a personal level and at a public policy level. So what advice do you give our policymakers, everybody being gathered here in New York now? How do we think about this and address it politically in a way that makes it palatable to be able to have a reasonable discussion on these issues?
I think that's a very good question, Carlos, and of course a very complex question. I think there are a number of ways by which you can sort of show the light on the direction in which countries in Asia need to move. Firstly, I think the core benefits are enormous from moving in that kind of direction and reducing emissions of greenhouse gases. Unfortunately, very few politicians, and I would say even those who have an influence on public perceptions, know this fact or talk about it. Because I think they are so focused on the pattern of development that you have seen in the OECD nations that they really don't think of, much less devise, a system by which you can be different and yet be able to grow. So I think there's need for a lot of intellectual effort in that regard, and I don't see that happening. The second thing that I suppose one would have to bring about to carry conviction with the developing countries is some means by which financing of the marginal cost can be organized. I've always felt that if there was some means by which you don't necessarily give grant money, but let's say low interest financing of some of the things that are desirable for a global and therefore also for local reasons, maybe that would provide an incentive. Japan, for instance, has the ability to do that. They have very low interest finance, which goes with their development assistance. But, you know, they too have been focusing largely on infrastructure, large infrastructure projects, which is understandable because development will only take place if you invest in that kind of infrastructure. But we're talking about the Global Climate Fund, for instance. Why can't we, under that umbrella, ensure that there's low interest financing for specific technologies? That, to my mind, will be a win-win situation. Yes, it will involve some cost on the part of the developed countries, but it would certainly make it very attractive for the developing countries to bring about these major investments. And thirdly, I think we also have to look at some of the physical limitations to using more coal, to using more oil or gas. In the case of India, I can tell you, we're not going to be able to produce very much more coal. In the last few weeks, we've been making a series, my institute has been making a series of presentations to the new government, to the ministers in the new government. And I find it very surprising when you tell them that we're going to run into a serious constraint in supply of coal. They don't believe you. But the fact is, a lot of India's coal is in locations where there will be environmental problems, like these are forest areas. A large part of our coal is also at depths where mining is going to be very difficult. And India is already importing about 100 million tons a year of coal from other countries, which is going to go up very rapidly. I don't see that coming from anywhere. Mm-hmm. And the kind of infrastructure you'd have to create for port handling facilities, transportation inland and so on, is a cost that nobody has sort of featured in this kind of option. So I think you really need to strategize and come up with these three or four approaches by which Asia would find it of direct benefit to move away from this pattern of development. And I think there ought to be a serious debate and dialogue on how to make this happen. Okay.
Pachauri, that's very helpful. Let me suggest, why don't you come and sit down, okay. And let me ask Ted if you want to come up and if there are any sort of broader themes you want to share with us, and then we can ask Mike to do the same, and then we'll go into a discussion in three. And he's given you you know, something to tee you up to begin lower interest finance for renewable energy and energy efficiency. I don't know if you want to take that up, but Mike's already looking at me saying, you know, he's already lectured me many times about subsidizing or not subsidizing interest rates, but we'll give you an opportunity to come to that as well.
Well, thank you. First of all, what a privilege it is to be here with both of you and with my friend and competitor, Mike. So this is a great opportunity. And as I look out at this audience, I become more optimistic because I see young, engaged, committed people. Let me start off, and Dr. Pachauri had just a wonderful presentation. As I look at this, I like that terrible joke on TV, I've got good news and I've got bad news. So I'm going to start off with the bad news. Emissions are clearly increasing globally. They're increasing in this country marginally. We're doing a good job by decreasing coal, but globally, China, India, and even in Germany, emissions are going up. For some complicated reasons, they're using more coal now. And the target that we've set of 2 degrees centigrade, we're going to miss that, unfortunately. We're going to exceed that unless policies change so extraordinarily dramatically, but that's unreasonable to think they'll change that fast. Now, the good news is that we see in the United States political outpouring of a sort that we haven't seen before. The march on Sunday, I think, was fabulous. The percent of people in the United States who are beginning to recognize that climate change is a serious issue is increasing, and that's good. The president is clearly personally very committed to it, and he pushed the EPA hard on Rule 111D, and that's good. But that's not enough. Unless climate change is your top one or top two issue, voters aren't going to vote for politicians who care about it. They're going to vote for politicians who care about things that are sort of more important to the voters. Maybe it'll be jobs. Maybe it'll be your tax bill. Maybe it'll be education, all of which are important issues. But somehow, collectively, we've got to make climate change politically is more important so we can get the changes in Congress that we need. Now, the business community, in my opinion, is becoming much more progressive on this. Utilities know that they're going to have to change. If you look at the regulated utility today, they are coming close to becoming a stranded asset in the sense that they know that distributed electricity is going to represent a serious challenge to the way that they're doing business. And this is a little ironic because you go back 100-odd years, there was an intellectual debate between Thomas Edison and Samuel Ensel, who was the person who really created the centralized utility. Edison's view was, let's have a generator in everybody's house. Ensel said, no, that's not going to work. We've got to have large centralized generator. We're going to have wires running all over the place. Well, at the time, that was clearly a better decision. But that's not necessarily the right way we want to go. Distributed electricity, and Dr. Pachauri talked about that a little bit. Business also, unlike politicians, is better equipped to deal with risk management when you have uncertain or incomplete information. That's what CEOs get paid to do, deal with. And you're seeing business is beginning to recognize this. I also want to applaud the students in this country who have started a serious debate on disinvestment. I was out in Colorado not long ago, and there were students from Stanford, University of Denver, Harvard, and so forth, and they talked about it. What really impressed me about it, they were talking amongst themselves. The degree of coordination was fabulous. And I suddenly said, gee, I think I've seen this before. When I was roughly your age, we were having similar protests at Harvard about the war in Vietnam. And I was a little skeptical of it. I said, you know, I'm not sure. How can we know more than the people in Washington? I now learn that that's an assumption I'll never make again. And they did. But that ultimately had an impact and led to President Johnson not running again. It was a good thing. So what are the solutions to this? One of which is that we need to make more investments in technology so that we can lower the cost of renewable energy. Dr. Pachauri was very clear, and I agree, that renewable energy generally is more expensive than buying electrons from fossil fuel. And to most people, if you've got a kilowatt that's produced by green energy and a kilowatt by fossil fuel, you don't really care. Kilowatts are commodities. What you really care about is the price. So we need to get the price of renewable energy so not only do we reach grid parity, it has to be lower. It has to be lower so the market incentives are such that you will fuel the investments you'll need to have more renewable energy. You also want to, and Dr. Pachauri talked about this a little bit, the concept that backwards sometimes can be an advantage. Most of you, I assume, have traveled out of this country, and when you come back to Kennedy, your airport, you're dismayed. Dear Lord, this is such an appallingly bad airport. But when you leave Beijing, the airport is magnificent. It's clean, it runs, it's efficient. Well, the Chinese didn't have to tear down an old airport to build a new one. They just started from scratch and built a state-of-the-art airport. When you go to Africa now and you see, or India for that matter, and you see the degree which cell phones are in the hands of everybody. They didn't have to tear down a wireline system. They just built a system and they leapfrogged into the 21st century. Well, we can do the same kind of thing, I think, when it comes to renewable energy. The idea that we're going to be able to have more distributed electricity is one that I feel very strongly about. But we have to make the investment in technology so we will have carbon capture sequestration. We're going to need carbon capture sequestration even for natural gas, because while it produces less carbon than does burning coal, it still produces carbon. We're going to have to capture it. And then we're going to have to be willing, and I'm going to get way ahead on my skis here. We're going to have to be willing to think about things like this. Some of my scientific friends say, Teddy, that's just impossible. But they same friends would have told me a decade ago, the idea of the internet would have been impossible. They wouldn't have recognized that we can change that quickly. So let me give you an analogy. If you're in a bathtub and the faucets are on and by gosh, it's overflowing. Well, you can turn off the faucets. But we're in a situation where, in terms of climate change, it's very hard to turn off the faucets. We can turn them off a little bit. We can keep tightening them down and produce less and less emissions. But we got the water that's still going to flow out of the bathtub. So what do? You pull the plug out of the bathtub. We have to do something that's analogous to that. We have to find a way of sequestering more carbon out of the atmosphere. Conventional wisdom talks about doing that through agriculture, more reforestation, restoring the grass biome, which is the biome that's been most damaged of all the biomes. But there are some technologies that are coming out. They are not commercial yet, but I find really interesting, where you can actually absorb CO2 out of the atmosphere, take it, and then sell it to bottling companies, and they put it in Pepsi-Cola or Coca-Cola. At least it's an economic way of recycling it. You can put it into for enhanced oil recovery, and it goes into caverns, and it'll stay there hopefully permanently. But if we learn how to really capture it, maybe you can find other ways of using that CO2. Maybe we can mix it with concrete so it'll become a form of construction, and then it's pretty permanent if it's in buildings. So we need to invest. And so one of the things in terms of policies, two basic things we need to do. We need dramatically, globally, but particularly in the United States, we need to increase research and development. And our research and development budgets at the federal level, at the state level, and even in the private sector have dropped precipitously from where they were, say, two or three decades ago. And that's unconscionable because we need to make the scientific advances. And then the final thing, obviously, is we need to put a price on carbon. And oil companies recognize that that's probably the most efficient and they're comfortable about it. Friends of mine at ExxonMobil say, we would much prefer a price on carbon. It's transparent. We can understand it. It works. So the business community isn't jumping with joy at the idea, but they recognize it's something that has to happen. And so we have to make it politically possible and push hard for a price on carbon to happen. And if we get that done, I think you're going to see the markets really begin to move. You're going to see money flowing to these areas. Because if you put a price on carbon, one of the things is the price of carbon, if you put a price on carbon, the cost of that, and you can talk about politically whether they want to make it revenue neutral. That's what all my Democratic friends want to do. And the irony is here I'm a Republican. I say, no, you want it to be produce revenue so we can invest in infrastructure. We want to invest in R&D. And my Democratic friends are scared. No, we can't do that. No, we've got to think for the future how we're going to use this money to make us smarter and better and invest in the very things that we need and recognize that as a nation, we are financially not that strong, and we therefore need to take this revenue and ways to make. But the advantage of doing that is that, amongst other things, you will decrease dramatically health care costs. The cost of respiratory diseases for small particulate matter is astronomical. We're spending hundreds of billions of dollars a year to deal with this. And if you go into in most African countries, again, leapfrogging, and that's my last comment, if you can replace kerosene stoves and the use of kerosene inside small little huts with solar power so people have lights at night or a little bit of electricity to use it for whatever they need it, the cost of respiratory disease in Africa exceeds the cost of AIDS and HIV, HIV and AIDS and malaria. So let's really recognize the externalities that Dr. Pachauri was talking about. And this is just basically economically being economically and financially smart. So I've talked enough. So
Ted, thank you very much. Why don't you come and join us here? And let me invite Michael Eckhart from Citigroup, Michael, to add any other general comments that you want, just to frame the issue, and then we'll come back to a discussion among the three of you.
Well, I first want to say, here we are at a university setting, and I'm among people I want you to know that I admire greatly. Jason has been a leading light in Washington on energy policy, not just clean energy, but all energy at the White House. And Carlos, you have, Ambassador, you have been a leader at the State Department, and you know that I admire everything you've done, and we've seen each other around the world at various events, and it's great to see you here. And also David Sandelow. David was Assistant Secretary for International Policy at Department of Energy under President Clinton, and then headed the climate change wing of the Clinton Global Initiative for many years, and I followed David in many places. And Dr. Pachauri, you know, even when I travel to India, I try to get an audience with you, and so it's great to be here. Great to be here. And Ted, you're a great competitor, and your sponsorship of the Cape Wind project, when it was unpopular, and you stood by it, and was financial advisor all these last 10 years as that very important project pushed forward. You've made yourself a hero of mine as well. So I'm among heroes, and so I'll add a few thoughts. I think the opening line of many of the talks I give is that we are 40 years into a 100-year transition to a clean energy economy. It didn't start yesterday, and it won't be over tomorrow. Okay, we're getting pushed back. Why are we getting pushed back? Because we're winning. If you want to be in the coal, nuclear, oil, or gas business, well, gas is winning, but the rest of them are losing, and we're winning. Clean energy is winning. Now, I started this in 1976, when I was your age, all right, and joined Booz Allen and Hamilton, which was then a leading consulting firm, has since split up, but in the energy practice. And I won a contract at the age of 28 years old to do 3 years of rifle shot studies on all the new energy technologies, and the contract was paid for by the White House. Jimmy Carter wanted rifle shot studies not published for his reading only, and I did those studies for 3 years. And we did solar and wind and hydro and fuel cells and cogeneration and energy efficiency and energy storage and coal gasification, liquefaction, oil shale, shale gas, breeder reactors, you name it, we did these series of studies. And so I'm the only person ever paid for years just to study all these technologies. And I'm still doing that. And I went to General Electric and I worked in nuclear. And then something I leave off my resume because it's too controversial is I was vice president of corporate marketing of combustion engineering. I was the chief marketeer at the age of 34 of coal-fired power in the world, right? I marketed coal-fired power and then went on and did gas-fired cogeneration projects as an IPP and then said, full stop, I'm only doing solar energy from now on in the mid-90s. Ended up founding Acor and have been in renewable energy ever since. And all of this required financing, so now I'm at Citi doing the financing. The reason I'm mentioning this is not me, I'm mentioning it because of you. You, at the university level, are starting and thinking about what you're going to do with the rest of your life. And you can actually decide what you can do. I was in a conversation with Neville Williams, a very famous guy in the solar business, and I made some wisecrack about India. And he said, Mike, you've never even been to India. What are you talking about? I was so mortally embarrassed. 3 weeks later, I'm in India. I was going to overcome that embarrassment and ran into R.K. Pachauri, that was in 1995, was already rising as a world leader. You can decide what you're going to do with your life. And I would suggest that if you're in this room, you're already thinking about what you're going to do, and you're going to spend your life dealing with this climate issue and dealing with clean energy and dealing with the lifestyle that the world has and finding a way that we can have a wonderful lifestyle without destroying the earth. And how many of you have been thinking these thoughts? Yes? A few? No? Is there someone here that has not had that thought? Okay. Well, all of this requires financing. And as I was well into building the American Council on Renewable Energy, and you can choose to do something like that if you want, I just woke up one day and said, I'm going to start the American Council on Renewable Energy. And you can do that. And then said, well, where this is going is financing, and I want to go do that. You can do that. All this requires is $1 trillion a year of capital flow. Now, is that a big number or a small number? Well, there's about $10 trillion a year of capital flow in the business world, not counting government and all that. So this is just one-tenth. It's nothing. We can actually solve this problem with one-tenth of the capital flow in the world. There's $130 trillion of capital in the world, if you didn't know. There's about $70 trillion in the debt markets and about $60 trillion in the equity markets. And all we need is $1 trillion a year. Now, we're doing about $250 billion a year right now in renewable energy, roughly. But we need to increase it by a factor of four. That's actually quite a lift. But again, in relation to $130 trillion is sitting out there invested, and we need to get $1 trillion a year here. The bond market places $7 to $8 trillion a year. The equity market places $2 to $3 trillion a year. We only need $1 trillion. So the reason Ted and I are here is because we're working on this, and it's working. There's Citi. I work at Citigroup. We led the effort to define, in the corporate world, green bonds. We wrote a guideline called the Green Bond Principles, which has been adopted by about 75 financial institutions around the world. It's only 7 months old, already 75, and it's gaining about five a week. The major banks are all signing up for this to define what is green bonds. And the innovation there is to shift our focus from the old SRI. Who knows what SRI means? Socially responsible investing, okay? The SRI world 20 years ago defined socially responsible investing to invest in only green companies, good socially responsible companies. Well, socially responsible companies means they're there today because of the cumulative effort of their entire history. So you're really defining the goal in history. Green bonds changes that and says, we don't care how green you are today. We care how green is your next use of funds. Where's your next dollar going? That's what green bonds is about. It's about raising money in the bond market to deploy that money in your next use of money. Doesn't matter what you did yesterday. What matters is where you're going. And so innovation is happening every day now in the financial community. That's why I'm here, just to say, and you can join that. We've created yield codes, which pay dividends on wind and solar assets so equity investors can invest. We're securitizing solar leases into the capital markets. And now we're placing, let's see, yesterday was placed $2 billion of green bonds. We're placing green bonds. We're doing yield codes. This is all innovations in the capital markets. So if you'd like, join us in the capital market world, join us in the banking world as you get out of school, and help create this river of capital to the right purposes. Because it's not going to happen if we just wish it to happen. Now, I have two daughters. One works for NextEra in San Francisco, investing in solar projects. Not bad. Wish I had her job. That's 40 years after I did my studies, so my daughter's actually implementing that. And the other works for HSBC in London, and she's in banking. So I have one in banking, one in solar, and I'm in solar banking. So we're all working together. So I invite you, my last line is, I invite you to join this very enjoyable profession in all categories, whether engineering, science, finance, whatever, of creating a society that doesn't destroy the earth. Thanks.
So one thing we've learned as a result of this is that in addition to everything else, Ted and Mike, we're going to keep inviting you as motivational speakers to come to student groups because you two of you are just fantastic. Dr. Pachauri is going to have to leave a little bit early, so I'm going to just jump into a couple of questions real quick and then take questions from the audience. But let me start with this river of capital theme and just ask you a practical question. India. Huge market, needs phenomenal amount of investment in renewable energy, energy efficiency. Ted, Mike, as competitors, how do you view the Indian market, and would you compete to try to get into it, and what are some of the factors that affect that are affecting your choices?
Well, I suspect that we're both in the market, all right. Oops. I suspect that we're both in the market. I know we are, and I know damn well you're in the market over there. So we see some pretty good opportunities in India, and one of the things that I find very interesting are the number of clever, creative entrepreneurs that are coming up with great ideas, one of which struck me not long ago, which came in and made a presentation. We want to take all the rice husks and gather it up and use it to fire little mini generators, biomass, and we've got a plan where we don't have to truck it very far. It won't get burned. If it gets burned, it just puts a lot of pollution in the air. These are the kind of clever ideas. And one of the things about human beings is how clever we can be if the right incentives are put in place. And we're seeing that happen in China. We're seeing it in India. One of the things that happened as a result of the EPA come out with Rule 111D, the Chinese wanted to talk to us at a more intensive level. What are you doing now? Share this idea with us. And they're putting a price on carbon. And I think I'm encouraged to see more and more collaboration between some of the important nations. Can we do more collaboration? Of course we can. And we still, as Dr. Pachauri was so eloquent, there still is a question of equity we need to address. And my final comment on this, I'll go back on the bully pulpit for a second, is leave you with a concept, and we in the United States really have to understand that. Less is more. We don't have to live in such big houses. We can drive smaller cars. Less is more.
So, Mike, let me go to you and pick up on that. I suspect you're in the market in India as well, but the challenge that we face is, and here I'll reverse that, more is more, in that you got to do more of it. You got to take more of these good ideas and do more of those, more of them. And we need to do that on a radically sharper basis because we're not going fast enough. So how do we get to doing more of it? What would make you willing to do more of it?
Well, speaking of India, I got an award, the Renewable Energy Man of the Year of India in 1998. So I figured nobody would believe that. So I have the award on my credenza, and then I have a photograph next to it of me getting the award so that people actually know I actually got it. I spent a lot of time in India in the 90s in solar energy financing. And I would say this, it's the reason I believe, Jason, what you're doing, and David, and Carlos, and Dr. Pachauri, that energy is driven by public policy and economics. There's two things going on. The economics are what they are, cost-based economics. I believe we're transitioning from a world of cost-based energy industry to market-based, now to values-based. We're starting to put value on non-pollution, things like that, so we're moving from costs to markets to values, and we're in a big transition. But in India specifically, it's a great case example, and I think Dr. Pachauri should address this after I comment, that the lack of clear and stable policy will stop this in its tracks and will prevent it from succeeding. You know, we have, in the U.S., it's not so stable, it's very unstable, but at least it's specific. That we have 50 states, we have 50 public utility commissions, we have gas regulation at the FERC level, we have government policy in everything except oil, which is an unregulated space, but certainly in gas and electricity, we have a policy framework within which we invest, within which the financing happens. If policy is uncertain, no capital moves. Imagine you're investing your mother's money. That's the way to think of this. Would you invest in a wind farm in India, you know, with your mother's money? Well, you'd want to know what's the deal. What's the policy? Is it going to live? Is it going to stay there? It's very reasonable of you to think that way. That's the way capital decisions are made, just like you're investing your mother's money, very carefully. And if public policy is uncertain, unstable, argumentative, changing all the time, you don't know what it's going to be tomorrow, you're not going to invest, you're not going to lend. And India has been a bit unstable and argumentative in the idea of debate. Now, in this area of renewables, I mean, the Indian Renewable Energy Development Agency, IREDA, was established, I think, Dr. Pachauri, in 1982. This is 22 years old, that India is committed to renewables, but hasn't got that flywheel moving yet. And so it's a great case that public policy matters. So if that's what you're working on, it matters.
Patrick, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I think as was mentioned, India actually established a department for new sources of energy way back in 1982. And soon after that, they set up this financial institution called IREDA. But the pity of it is that investments in the sector have not really taken place because, as was rightly stated, we've not had a continuity of policy. As it happens, India is a federal structure, so a lot of decisions, particularly in the energy sector, are in the hands of the state governments. And it's often happened that, for instance, a state government will provide incentives for establishment of wind power, but these are then reviewed after a few years and taken away or modified. So there really hasn't been a proper continuity in policies, at least at the level of the states, and to some extent even at the federal level. What is really required, and I hope that would happen, this is something that we would certainly advise the government to do, is for the federal government, the central government, to hold a dialogue with all the state governments and then come up with a policy pronouncement and a policy direction that would essentially give continuity and give some security for business policy. And one can see in retrospect that not doing so is extremely harmful. And it does damage to the industry, it does damage to the country, and the overall objective of moving towards a sustainable energy supply. I have to apologize. I think I'll leave in about 2 minutes.
Dr. Pachauri, I know you have to leave, I'm going to, rather than try to force the questions and for you to answer them quickly, let me just ask you, from the various comments you heard, any final sort of thoughts you want to give us? And then perhaps if other colleagues can stay for a few minutes, there may be a few comments from the audience.
Yeah, I mean, from what I've heard, I'm very encouraged. And from what I've seen also on this visit to New York, and the fact that we now have a new government in office in India, which is clearly committed to greater use of renewables. We've been interacting regularly with the new energy minister. And it's also a fact that the current prime minister, when he was chief minister of a state, did an enormous amount to expand renewable energy supply. So it would be very productive, in my view, to organize some kind of a meeting of the heads of financial institutions and government agencies in India to map out a new roadmap. Because there has to be continuity of policy. And I think Mike was right when he said that. And I mean, my institute would be very happy to take the lead in that and convene something of this nature. Because it's high time we realize that this is something which involves partnership between business and industry and government. Otherwise, it's not going to happen.
Patsy, that's a tremendous idea. It's a great thing that you mentioned that with Barclays and Citigroup at the table. We look forward to their competition, to rushing forward to help finance that idea between TERI and the Center on Global Energy Policy. We'll have a discussion with these guys afterwards. If I can ask Ted and Mike to stay for a couple minutes, but we'd really like to give you a huge hand for everything you've done.
Thank you.
So good to see you.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Let's do that.
And part of Dr. Pachauri's activism, he's annually conducted a U.S.-India Energy Partnership and a summit, which is held in Washington, D.C., and then he will be conducting that next week in parallel with Prime Minister Modi's visit. So it's just an indication of the kind of dialogue that they're really trying to promote with the private sector. Let me turn to the audience for questions, and I'll take questions two at a time. So let me start here, and we'll go over there, please. There's a mic right here.
Oh, thanks. Assuming we can come to some sort of consensus on pricing carbon, how do we ensure that all of the that the price is high enough and that all of the far-reaching implications of climate change across the life cycle of these technologies are accounted for? I can envision a scenario where the price might be too low and then production and consumption increase because the guilt factor is gone.
Okay. And let me take a question over here. Just on this, right in the corner.
Thanks. Just two quick questions. One, Mr. Roosevelt.
One quick question.
You mentioned that global energy companies are coming out in favor of a price on carbon, and several have been saying this for several years, which is great. But several of them are also still funding politicians and think tanks that deny the science of climate change, let alone oppose a price on carbon. When do you think they're going to start putting their money where their mouth is?
Okay, why don't you hand the mic next to you? We've got two questions on carbon.
There was discussion of the lowering of prices for renewables, but could you comment on nuclear energy?
Okay. Why don't we come back and start on the carbon issue, the issue of getting the price right so that you don't have so cheap of a price that it becomes a self-justified thing where you can pay the cost of using coal for power generation, you feel good about it, but you're actually just putting more carbon in the atmosphere. And then when do you get to a scale that this starts, how do you get to a scale that this becomes politically viable? You started to talk about that issue politically and some of the challenges politically in the United States. You want to start on that, Tim?
All right, well, let me attempt to do so. There have been sort of two approaches to putting a price on carbon. One is cap and trade. The cap very clearly says you can't emit more than whatever the cap is, and you can continually ratchet the cap down. The caps haven't worked as well as we would have liked to see them work, partly in Europe because they didn't put them over enough of the economy. They exempted a large part. and in the United States, we attempted to put a cap in place. And it had a political problem that we really haven't been able to solve. Let me try to explain what I mean by that. If you're going to price the incremental megawatt of electricity based on whatever the cost of the electricity is in a particular state, so let's say in Georgia, the cost of the incremental megawatt will be determined by burning coal. And that, if you've got a cost of $20 per ton of carbon, that means your incremental megawatt will cost $21 more. If you go to Texas, the incremental megawatt is determined by the price of natural gas. So for $20 price per ton of carbon, that only works out to $13. You can see the political problem that creates immediately. Why should a senator, and it's why it never got through the Senate, why should a senator from Ohio or Georgia say, gee, we want to see our incremental megawatt cost $8 more than in Texas? And that created a problem, and it was pretty clear to some of us, even though I supported cap and trade, that it wasn't going to pass the Senate. We didn't come up with a solution for that. The second political problem in the United States, and I'm going to finally get that to specifically ask you a question, is Mike and I work for an industry that's not held in great repute in this country right now. And the idea that we were going to make markets in carbon, I think made it politically impossible to see the Senate actually vote for it. We got it through the Ledgerman, and he was brilliant, of Henry Waxman. We got it through the House of Representatives. But if you look at that bill, it really wasn't that good a bill. It had a lot of exemptions, it did lots of things, and it was an internally inconsistent bill because that was what was necessary to get the votes to get it passed. You had to give a little bit here, a little bit there. And unfortunately, the White House never really played the role that it should have, which is said, look, here's how we think we're going to see a coordinated bill. So getting the price right, What you have to do, I think, is come up and say the object of putting a price on carbon is to get the markets to do exactly what you want them to do, which is you want to see money flow into the renewable, and you want to see the cost of renewables is, pick a number, 10 or 15 or 20% lower than the cost of buying electricity from conventional fuel. That's what your objective is. So the price has to be high enough to achieve that objective. And I'm sure you've got thoughts that you might want to...
Mike, do you want to pick up on that? And maybe given your stint in the nuclear world as well, if you want to pick up on that. There's another mic right next to you that purportedly works.
Is this working? No?
Yeah. All right.
Boy, am I good at this.
We got too many of these. You keep giving me things. This is good. I like this. All right. I've had two very important people personally say to me that they're in favor of a carbon tax versus cap and trade. One was about 6 years ago, Al Gore, sitting in the Rocky Mountains on a lake under a tree. And I was saying, why aren't you out there on this whole climate thing? As well, all my friends are for cap and trade, and I'm not for cap and trade, and I don't want to be speaking against my friends, so I'm just saying nothing. So that's why Al Gore's been saying nothing, because he's in favor of carbon tax. So then in February, I was at the Oslo Energy Forum, which is the Davos of oil CEOs, and I had been asked to give the climate talk, and I'm here to say I survived having done that. Courage.
What's that wound?
Yeah. Right. So we've all done dangerous things in our lives. But Rex Tillerson, the CEO of ExxonMobil, when he was speaking at this little gathering, is about as big as this meeting right here, said he was very much against any policy on climate, and he got red in the face and was spitting when he was saying it. But then said, if we had to have a policy, the only thing he'd be in favor of is a carbon tax, revenue neutral, where all the money goes to payroll taxes. And that's exactly what Al Gore said. So going in dinner that night, I mentioned to him there's one other person that said exactly what he had said, and he needs to know who it was, but he's going to be angry when I tell you. And I said, it's Al Gore, and he was angry. So I'm very good at predicting things. But really, these two ends, the two ends of the barbell have come to the same, political barbell have come to the same answer. Look, cap and trade is a tricky way of setting a carbon tax, and it liquidates it nicely. The nice thing about it is it liquidates it immediately to the good thing. It doesn't go through a Department of Carbon Tax Agency in Washington. It goes right from the don't do this to the do this. It goes right from the coal to the wind farm, right in the system. It's beautiful. The problem is it's a rigged deck. It's an artificial market created by government. And so the market is managed by a government agency, if you will, a bureaucracy, to create, and you see that in Europe today, is they're trying to, it didn't work, and so, you know, carbon, is selling for $5 a ton when it should be selling for $35 a ton. Now you have bureaucrats waiting in trying to figure out how to trick the market to become what they want it to be. And so it has its flaw, and the carbon tax has its flaw in that the money will go through government and then back out to some good purpose and probably get stolen in the meantime. So there isn't a perfect answer here. But I lean a little bit towards the carbon tax, but I insist we call it a carbon fee, like a tipping fee dumping, because what we're doing is we're paying for dumping carbon in a landfill called the air, all right? So that we have tipping fee. So how about a carbon fee rather than a carbon tax? Because the tax, you have to do it. And that way we can just set the number, make it $35 and move on. The problem is the political process, if it does pass it, it's gonna pass it at a level that's too low to have an effect in order to just get it passed. Otherwise, they won't pass it. And so again, everything is flawed. But I lean towards the carbon tax with the money going to reduce payroll taxes. And Rex Tillerson's a smart guy, because he just paid $35 billion to buy a gas company, which is competing against coal. So the carbon tax is going to kill coal. So he wins. And with money going to reduce payroll taxes, he can tell his employees, I got you money. So he kills his competition and pays his employees. So that's a little self-interest there. But that's how things get passed, is through self-interest. And we come up with a package that wins for the most people, and it's going to pass. On nuclear power, I actually oversee nuclear power at Citi because I'm the only person that ever worked in nuclear power currently working at Citi. And that's a reflection right there of the situation. Post-Fukushima world, I'll just say really quickly, the big thing is nuclear power was born in the... commercial nuclear power in the U.S., Europe, and Japan. All three are out of business because we've had Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, and Fukushima, And when you have an accident in your home, it's over. All right, that leaves Russia and China and Korea. 10 years from now, well, the average age of the nuclear workers in the United States is 58, which tells you we've got a problem. 10 years from now, they will all retired. 10 years from now, all the nuclear engineers in the world will be living in China, Korea, and Russia, and not in the U.S., Europe, and Japan. And so the safety of the whole thing is going to be in the hands of Russia, China, Korea, not U.S., Europe, Japan. That's the issue to focus on. Jason, that's the issue that the center should be dealing with, which is where is the center of expertise in nuclear power? Who owns this technology going forward? What does that mean for geopolitics? And it's going to be terrible. It's going to be, this is a dangerous situation we're walking into, and we can predict it just from the age of the workers, so what's going to happen. China bought 4 AP1000 reactors from Westinghouse. They're not even built yet, and China's already announced the CP1000 China technology. Hello, it's called IP theft, and that's what's going on. So nuclear is moving geographically, which is going to create geopolitical issues that we haven't even contemplated yet. So that's my take on nuclear.
Let me just add to that, if I can.
Jump in here, Ted, because I wish we can keep going. We're already over time, and we have made a commitment that we're going to have to close these sessions on time. One of the lessons from this is that there's a lot more we have to talk about, so we're going to keep inviting you guys to keep coming back here. I'm going to ask first one thing. David Sanzlo, a great friend and colleague who was undersecretary in the Department of Energy under Secretary Chu and with President Obama, is now at the center. One of the things he's doing is he's running a great project that is just starting up right now on climate change. David, do you want to say a quick advertisement on what you're seeking to do?
This we think is the only live one up here.
Thank you, Carlos. Thank you for this great session also to Ted and to Mike. Since we're over time, I'm going to do it in two sentences. We are launching a project right now on the negotiations happening right now headed towards the Paris climate talks. If anybody's interested, please come talk to us about it. We think these are going to shape the world's discussions on climate in the years ahead, and we want to do some important analysis to help with this.
Great. David, the center, one of the things the Center on Global Energy Policy has been doing is really to stimulate debate, discussion, analysis, and then practical action on these issues at the intersection of energy, markets, finance, and climate. So this is part of that series. We will be continuing with that series, and you've already given us a lot of food for thought and discussion about where to continue some of those sessions. And in particular, what we want to keep coming back to is how to be able to actually do more in some areas. And I don't make a habit of disputing Mahatma Gandhi, but if you're going in the wrong direction and you're going in the wrong direction faster, this is one of those cases where it actually does matter, because it makes it a lot worse and a lot harder to get back to where we need to be. So we need to have an impact on that. We invite you to keep following us on our website for upcoming events, to follow us on Twitter. It's at Columbia U Energy, and at Facebook. I'd also say a word about a report that was just done, released on Monday. Some of you are aware of it, but it's on U.S. LNG exports, its impact on Europe and European energy security, plays into the situation in Russia and Ukraine. It's right there, and you can and download that on the Center website. One of Jason's innovations has been to be able to put some of these events on a podcast series. And so we'll be sending out emails about how you can get access to those podcasts. But what we want to do is continue this kind of dynamic intersection with the student community, the faculty community, the business community, and to see how we can bring together ideas that really stimulate action. So thank you very much for joining us today. A big hand for our panelists, and a thank you for sharing your wisdom.